You know, you need to tune in if you want to hear them, you know. So we Chad, Josh, Demetrius, and Marcus every Friday. You know.
It's the Square Round Table.
Tune in.
It's the Square Round Table. Tune in every Friday. Let's have a blast. I know at work you had a long day. Just relax and tune in.
Make sure you tune in weekly, every Friday. MajorZoneMusic.com. We also tune on Spotify, iHeartRadio, and YouTube. So yeah.
All right, what's going on, my freaks and geeks? This is the Square Roundtable Podcast. I want to thank you all for joining us today. Look, guys, I've been wanting to talk to this guy for a very long time. We have a very special guest today. Please welcome horror researcher and author, Dr. Matthias Klassen.
What's going on, sir?
Yeah, it's awesome to be here. Lots of good vibes in the virtual studio. So I've been looking forward to talking about my work with you guys.
No, that's great. And the same thing here. I think the awesome thing for me is social media in general and just like how you can use like these different realms, especially now, as a vehicle to know or get to experience brand new things. Because the way I found you is because of your TED talk that you had. And I'm like a huge horror nerd. I love it. I take in so much horror content. I'm always searching for it, whether it's like a movie or something, or I read like horror stories online, or I watch short stories on YouTube. And I always like to hear like the background of who made them or what they mean psychologically. And naturally, because of the algorithm that I had on my YouTube page, I ran into your talk. And I was just, and once I listened to the whole thing, I was just like, wow, I have to talk to this guy. I need him on the podcast. So yeah, I'm certainly glad I was able to find you through YouTube.
Yeah, me too.
Yep, the algorithm when it works.
Exactly, that when it works, it really works. So just to get a little bit of a background on you, I wanted to know for you, what is your background like academically, and what made you want to start like researching horror or studying horror?
Yeah, my background is in literary and media study. So I have a PhD in English, and I spent most of my studies in English language literature, so the American and the British literary traditions. But I was always focused on the scary stuff, the dark stuff, and that fascination with frightening literature and also frightening movies goes way back in my own history. So it used to really freak me out when I was a kid. I would get terrible nightmares from reading ghost stories and so on. But then when I was a teenager, something weird happened, like a switch was flicked in my mind, and suddenly I felt drawn toward this stuff. So I would watch a lot of horror movies, slasher movies, read all of Stephen King's works, and read my way back through the literary tradition. And so I figured eventually I had to get an education, and I thought, I'm going to choose something where I get a chance to delve into this stuff. And so through a combination of stubbornness and luck, I was able to make an academic career out of my love for scary stories.
Wow. Okay. How did you form that idea? Was it something where you knew you would have to do something in literature right away? Or like, how did that idea come to be, like to just focus like solely in horror, like in academia?
Yeah, I think once you decide that you want to pursue an academic career, you have to narrow your scope and find a niche, find some corner of the world that has not been researched to death. And so I figured I'm going to combine my wish to pursue an academic career and become a researcher with my interest in horror. And people do research horror. And I'm not the only researcher in this field, but there is very little kind of scientific approach to horror. So most, if you look at academia, most horror scholars are old-fashioned humanistic types who read novels and analyze them and interpret them. But I thought that there was a need for more scientific work to really get into the psychological machine room of the genre. That's what's always fascinated me. What is it that makes people voluntarily seek out movies and stories that frighten them? Just like you described before, Chad, with being fascinated with scary stories. What's going on there? They make you afraid.
Exactly.
Nightmares. They might make you, you know, nervous to go into the basement. What gives?
Exactly. And we go into it so willingly. Like, that's why I thought your talk was very interesting. And I wanted to know, like, specifically, like, with our obsession and with, like, my obsession with horror, because it's so ingrained in our, like, media that we take in every day. Like, every other movie, whether it's good or bad, is horror. So what does that say, like, cognitively about human evolution?
Yeah, I think that's true, that horror is extremely pervasive. It's everywhere. It's not just in movies. It's in literature. It's in theater, haunted attractions, kids' stories, folk tales, video games. It's just everywhere. So what does it say about us that we're so fascinated with these stories that really what they do is they invite us to, like, imaginatively journey into a frightening world, a world that's not real, but that we can still enter into through the imagination. And I think what's really happening is that through biological evolution, humans evolved to find pleasure in playing with fear. And that's something we see from a very early age. Small kids really enjoy activities that allow them to play with fear, like chase games or hide and seek or even peekaboo. Yeah, yeah. And they like that because they know there is no real danger. It's just dad or mom or whoever pretending to be a monster. But they also feel the cold fingers of anxiety tickling them on their back. And it's that playful engagement with fear and anxiety and dread and terror that's appealing to us, because we learn important things about the world and also about our own emotional landscape. So if you watch a lot of horror movies or play a lot of horror video games or read a lot of horror stories, you will get a deeper appreciation of what it feels like to be afraid. And you will learn something about your own limits. What is my tolerance? How do I respond when I'm terrified? I know this not because I'm frightened in the real world, not very often, but because I've been in haunted houses and watched horror movies and so on. So there is a real learning potential. It's not just about screaming in terror when the monster jumps out and tears the head off the scream queen. It's also about getting insight and practicing coping strategies. Mm. So what can I do to regulate my own fear? That's something I know because I have lots of experience through horror media. So that's the long-winded answer. The short answer is that humans evolved to find pleasure in threat simulations, in playing with fear.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Because you get, like, really mad when you, like, when a horror movie doesn't scare you. I know, like, people, like, get, or a horror house, like, a haunted house isn't scary. People are just so mad because they're like, well, I came here for this experience. I came here to get that satisfaction, and I didn't get it. So, like, they'll rate a movie bad because they're like, this wasn't scary at all. I knew that this was going to happen. It was predictable, and this, that, the other. So they like that unpredictability of, like, haunted houses and stuff like that.
Exactly. I think that's exactly right. And that's a really important point, because previously, when people tried to explain the paradoxical appeal of horror, many people thought that the fear is not really the primary attraction. That's the price people pay. They don't really want to be scared. They want to see interesting stories that are dramatic and so on. But that's not true, because, as you say, if a horror movie is not frightening, people are not going to like it. And, right. And many horror movies and also haunted attractions are marketed on their ability to terrify people, like Paranormal Activity. When it came out, the trailer, it had these quotations from reviews that said, this is the scariest movie ever, and this movie is going to damage you psychologically. And they were selling points. And so that really brings the paradox into focus.
That's right. So, were you going to say something, Josh?
Not to step on your toes, Chad, but yeah, like, it's funny how, going back to how Chad said, a lot of things, there's a lot of horror within things that aren't even necessarily, like, directly related to horror, like people being in like relatively, like, basically circumstances that they might not want to see themselves in, like, for instance, I would say if you're watching a movie about, like, sports injuries, like if you're watching a movie about MMA or football, it might be horror as far as being in a specific situation, having to be in the ER for a bad injury. So I would say maybe sports has evolved in a way where people are interested in it because of situations like maybe a bad injury or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a really good point. And I have a friend and colleague at the University of Chicago. His name is Colton Scrivener, and his research is on morbid curiosity. And he's doing some really fascinating studies, and he's finding that morbid curiosity is a personality trait, which is normally distributed, which means that everybody has some amount of morbid curiosity. Everybody is, you know, fascinated with injuries and ghosts and the supernatural and violence and horror. And so it's not that people are weird or sick if they are drawn almost against their own will to the kinds of things you described just before, Josh. It's actually very normal. It's part of human nature that we want to learn about the dangers of the world. And so we have been designed, if you will, by biological evolution to find pleasure in learning about the morbid aspects of existence. And one way in which we can satisfy that craving for morbidity is through horror, but we can also satisfy it through other media. True crime would be another example.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, so that, I guess you could draw that line between paying a lot of money to go either to a haunted house, or, and then you can draw it between going to a MMA fight, because in either way, it's satisfying the same, I guess, kind of pleasure zone that we want to reach.
Yeah, I think so. I think it's ultimately about learning about danger, which is pleasurable to us. So we want to know what violence looks like. And sometimes we can't help but look if we drive past like a bad accident on the highway. We know we shouldn't. It's a little bit morally maybe tricky, but there is an appeal there. And it makes sense. Scientifically, it has now been shown to actually make sense, biologically speaking.
Wow. So I just want to know, like, where does that thirst come from? Is it like something to where now we have evolved to not be in dangerous situations like we would have been? Like, and is it a certain thing to where we just have to fill that void now? Like, where does that thirst come from exactly?
Yeah, that's a really good question, because certainly the world is less dangerous now than it was when people evolved, like, hundreds of thousands of years ago. So our ancestors, they rarely got older than 30, because they were eaten by big cats or bitten by poisonous snakes or beaten to death by other tribes or whatever. So we don't get that daily workout of the fear system. And I don't know, and nobody knows, because nobody has studied that particular question. We don't know whether that lack of actual danger kind of leaves us with a stronger craving for confronting danger in the fictional realm, but it could be.
Yeah,
exactly, because truly there's a difference, right? Because you have, like we talked about before, going to see sports or taking part in a morbid situation like watching a car accident, but truly it's a difference from going to a movie theater or watching some kind of like fantastic horror paranormal activity and knowing that this is the difference between reality and fantasy. I wanted to ask, is there a sort of like therapy in that, like a horror therapy that helps you, like that fantastical element helping you to deal with real world trauma? Is that the thing?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. And I think it's true that once there is an element of psychological distance, it becomes more enjoyable. So we don't like to, if you were walking on the street and you came across a corpse, you would probably feel compelled to look, but it wouldn't be enjoyable. But you can watch a movie in which the same thing happens to a fictional character and it's enjoyable. It's arousing. So the psychological distance has to be there for us to find it pleasurable. And one way in which you create psychological distance is through fiction. We know it's just made up. And I think this question of whether it's therapeutical is really good, because most horror research back in the 80s was very much focused on detrimental effects. So the ways in which kids could become traumatized from watching horror movies. So it's a whole media psychological research tradition that has documented that most people, like 90% of the population, have had some kind of more or less traumatic experience with a scary movie. Like when it's usually around the age of 10 or 11. And you sneak into the living room and your parents are watching something and you peek at it and it terrifies you. You can't sleep. Mm-hmm. Like Poltergeist and Jaws and Blair Witch Project and movies like that, terrifying generations. But we're now finding that there are also positive benefits. So we did one study in the beginning of the pandemic back in April 2020, where we thought maybe people who watch a lot of horror movies are actually doing a better job of surviving the pandemic psychologically.
And so that's interesting.
Yeah, and so we constructed a study in which we looked at the psychological resilience and how many horror movies people watch. And we found a relationship, which means that the more horror movies you watch, the better is your mental health during the pandemic. You're not as distracted. You don't have as many sleep problems or concentration problems. And we think it's because when you watch horror movies, it becomes a simulation of a dangerous situation that allows you to practice emotional regulation. So you're sitting in the darkness of your living room or a theater, and you're watching a scary movie, and you're trying to keep your fear down. Some people, they hold their hands up in front of their eyes, which, by the way, is a terrible coping strategy. It doesn't work.
No.
You should cover your ears, or you should think about something else, right? Use a cognitive coping strategy. It's much more effective. But just learning about those different ways in which you can keep your own fear down seems to generalize to the real world. So you learn it through watching horror movies, but you can also use it in the real world. For example, when you find yourself in the middle of a pandemic and the future is uncertain and people are dying. And so that was a really cool finding, that we could show this relationship between horror movie watching and psychological resilience. And we've done other studies since that strengthen this idea that at least some people use horror to learn about their own limits, their own tolerance, and to basically face the horrors of existence. So,
wow.
Yeah.
Mm. Wow, that's extremely interesting. And one thing that you mentioned also, we were talking a little bit about it before the podcast started. You were talking about your students and how it's been since having to teach primarily online. And we were joking around, just talking about how boring it's been. Mm. Did any part of your research cover like what part of the brain that horror sort of nurtures? Mm-hmm. So I would guess that in a way, a lot of people that watch horror or get pleasure from watching horror do better during situations like this, because they're having like a constant positive effect on their dopamine. Is that something that helps too?
We don't know, because there are almost no studies that look at the neurobiology and neurochemistry. So we know very little about the stress hormones and the neurotransmitters that are involved when you watch horror. There has to be these.
I would think.
Yeah, I think so too. But most of the studies we have done have been looking at personality and looking at behavior. And we've done a bunch of haunted house studies. But you can't really measure brain activity on people who are running through a haunted house screaming for dear life. So we've had to look at other physiology, for example, the way the heart responds to being jump scared in a haunted house by a crazy clown. That's the kind of thing. Yeah.
Yeah, I would die. Like, I.
Yeah.
Like, just a little background on me. Like, I hated when I was younger. And that's the funny thing about when you were talking about like that experience you have with like horror films. Like, first time I saw Stephen King's It, like, I was like a madman. Like, I felt like my heart was gonna like fall. But now I love it, you know what I'm saying? I can't get enough of it. So it's crazy sort of how that happens. And I wanted to ask you like more about how the mechanism for how horror works, because you talk about haunted houses and you talk about measuring people's heart rate. Now, certainly it's a thing to be scared, but not too scared. And I wanted to know, how does that work between like horror being looked at as something pleasurable versus something like disgusting? Like, how do you get to that Goldilocks zone for being scared, but not too scared? How does that work?
Yeah, actually, we did a study in a haunted house here in Denmark where the goal was to find that Goldilocks zone, as you so appropriately call it. We wanted to see if there is a sweet spot for horror with just the right amount of fear. And so we did find that if you can imagine like a graph where you have fear on one axis and pleasure on the other. So if you go to a horror attraction or a horror movie and you don't feel a lot of fear, the pleasure is going to be very low. It's not very fun for you because it's boring. Like Demetrius said before, you want to be scared. But then if you go to, like Chad, you mentioned before, watching It when you were younger and it terrified you, that was maybe an overload of fear. So it was also not very pleasurable. Right. But you can imagine an inverted U, like a U, the letter U upside down. That's the curve we found. So not enough fear, it's not pleasurable. Too much fear, it's not pleasurable. But just the right amount of fear and you love it. Yeah, but that sweet spot or the Goldilocks zone, it varies a little bit from person to person, depending on their personality, depending on their age, and depending on their experience. Like in my field, when I go to a staff meeting in the English department, I feel like I'm always the creepy dude with all the Stephen King novels in his office. Everybody else is doing respectable stuff, working with Shakespeare and poetry and things like that. So I think there is a bit of, I think there is a bit of a stigma associated with horror. So many people look down on it. They feel it's primitive because it's about bodily arousal and strong emotions, which is a big mistake for various reasons. But I think that stigma contributes to many people staying away from horror and so not really knowing what it is. And if you've never watched a horror movie because you think all horror is stupid 80s slasher movies, then probably it wouldn't require a lot to frighten you. So your sweet spot would be different from somebody like you or me who has exposed themselves to a lot of this material.
It's like a sweet spot. For example, that I'm thinking of like a sweet spot or the Goldilocks like zone is you want, like when you go to an attraction, they say, oh, this house is haunted. You like, you go in there wanting to see the ghost, like a ghost, but you don't want to see the ghost. Like you're like in that weird like zone where you're like, oh, okay, I came here to see a ghost, but I don't want to see that ghost they're talking about. So yeah. That's where that zone is.
Yeah.
Exactly. Like you get excited about being scared.
Yeah. Yeah, and I feel like, you know, every time I go to a haunted house, I'm really excited. And then when I'm standing in line, I'm asking myself, what the hell is wrong with you, man? What are you doing here? You don't want this. And then they go in and it's really fun.
Yeah, right. Exactly. And
we see that when we do these scientific studies in the haunted house, that there is a huge difference in the behavior of guests from before they go in until they come out on the other end. Because when they come out, they're laughing and they're talking and they're joking. And it looks like it's just a very kind of arousing, all around good experience. And it brings people together. That's something else that we're looking at right now is the bonding potential of horror, which is also interesting.
But it's just like in the back of my head about what about like the overstimulation of horror to the point where someone just likes to indulge in horror so much to where they need more of it and try to look for actual situations that are reminiscent to what they indulge in fiction. And they make it go to a point where they're violent or try to act out these particular events in real life. Like what is the psychological reasoning behind something like that?
I think that kind of phenomenon that you're describing is extremely rare. And it's true that sometimes you get a news story about some teenager who has watched horror movies from the time they got out of bed till the time they went to bed for 10 years. And now they decide to pick up a knife and go out in the street. But those cases are so extremely rare. And besides, there has been a lot of research on the relationship between aggression and violence and violent media. Does it turn you into a violent maniac to play violent video games? And no, it doesn't. The science is pretty clear by now. That causal relationship does not exist. It may be the case that people who are aggressively disposed are drawn to violent media. But violent media don't make people into aggressive individuals. So it's not something I would be concerned about. It's true that there can be a habituation effect where you watch many horror movies and you require something more extreme to stimulate you. But it doesn't seem to translate into, you know, behavior in the real world, because almost everybody is perfectly able to distinguish between fiction and reality. People are really good at that.
Yeah, the case you're talking about, the extreme case you're talking about, like the only thing I could think about was like a news article where these like teenagers saw like, I think Slender Man, and they like tried to reenact it. That was a special case, but like not everybody's gonna do that. That was just like, you know, if you say an extreme case, but that's the only thing I could think of off the top of my head, like that would be a case. But yeah, the science or whatever does say that there is no correlation between violent video games and violence in reality. But okay. I don't, and I think that's something that people need to have like an understanding of, or be like, okay, this is how it is, instead of just thinking, oh yeah, my kid's playing a violent video game, so he's obviously going to be violent in real life. It's not a correlation that they don't go together.
No, but a lot of parents feel that way and are concerned. Actually, I just finished a book on, it's called A Very Nervous Person's Guide to Horror Movies. And I try to go into those different concerns that people might have about horror, including horror being like a corrupting influence on children, which is not at all supported by the science. Quite the opposite. Wow. Kids can have really constructive and fun experiences with scary stories. Like, you don't want to show the most extreme stuff to a seven-year-old, of course, but they're still attracted to scary folktales or even Disney movies with frightening content.
Yeah.
So I was about to say the age appropriate horror for that age, because I know, like in my case, you don't want to have the kid passed out on the ground.
No.
But I've had a couple of those run-ins, so like I know how it is. Yeah. But yeah, that definitely makes a lot of sense. So I guess your book goes into that there isn't necessarily a negative, like reality-driven result from watching horror or taking in a lot of horror content. It was just psychologically, we just know how to differentiate the two, even from a younger age.
And yeah, and it's not like a lot of the, it's not like Disney, because Disney is a good example for taking horror stuff and like kid, like making it like a kid version. Because like most of like Little Mermaid and all these things are based off of like horror stuff, like from the Grimm's Tale. So they're able to take that horror element out and make it like kid friendly, all these stories. So it's like really interesting that when you find out the history of a lot of those Disney movies, that they come from like the horror genre.
Yeah, that's true. And then they tone it down, but still usually retain a little bit of scary stuff.
Yeah, like
the mom's always dying in old Disney movies.
Right.
That's
terrifying for a kid, right? Yeah, that's true. Well, I even love the older Grimm's Tales that are just like the original versions, because even though they, you know, might be a little more grotesque in a way, they still, the point of those stories is to teach a lesson. So I still appreciate those old stories. But I wanted to talk about the opposite end of what we've been harping on a little bit. Does any of your research cover like some positive physiological and psychological effects?
Not really physiological. That is something I did look into when I was researching for the book. But there's not a lot of science on physiological beneficial effects. There were some studies that seemed to suggest that you burn a lot of calories when you watch a horror movie.
That makes sense, right?
Yeah, it does make sense. So,
do we want to get a six-pack? Watch some horror movies.
Have a binge on horror movies.
Yeah.
Horror movie binge.
Yeah, mm-hmm. But the psychological benefits I am looking at and have been looking at with my collaborators. And I think mainly what we're finding so far are the pandemic study that I mentioned, the psychological resilience, which is a positive psychological benefit. Also, this whole emotion regulation that people, when they watch horror movies or read Stephen King novels or play video games that are frightening or go to haunted attractions, they become better at regulating their own emotions. They become better at keeping fear on a leash. And they have a better understanding of what it feels like to be afraid. They come to realize that you can be terrified for 90 minutes without the world coming to an end. That's the kind of thing that's important for kids, I think, and why you should let kids seek out scary stories. Not Texas Chainsaw Massacre, mildly frightening stuff.
Right.
They get a chance to learn what it feels like and find their own limits and maybe challenge their limits. I think that's another positive psychological effect of horror, is that it allows people to push their limits for how much fear and anxiety they can handle.
So it's like it teaches you like a coping mechanism, like not to be so afraid. Okay, this is something scary, but I need to go like bring it down, like calm down and think about what my next move is. That kind of helps you know, your fear.
Exactly. And I think that's an emotion you can use in many different domains of life. If you have an oral exam coming up or a job interview or a date or whatever, it's always good to be able to keep your emotions under control.
Makes sense.
And just to bring it up, like kind of just, I think like fear helps you like push the limits of what's like real and what's not. Because when I was younger, I used to have a fear of magicians because I was never able to differentiate like what was realistic and what wasn't. So I just think that's interesting as well.
Yeah. I think so. And I remember feeling a kind of similar thing about magicians, but then that anxiety turned into anger. I got so angry with them for duping me. And I knew they were, you know, creating illusions and they looked so real, but I knew it could not be real. So, you know, what the hell, guys? But I think, even for grownups, everybody is ultimately afraid of this barrier between fantasy and reality breaking down. It's certainly a theme in many horror movies like The Shining. Are the ghosts in Jack's mind or are they real? Or Rosemary's Baby. Are there witches who have implanted the seed of Satan in her body, or is she being paranoid? That's something we can relate to, most of us, I think.
100%. And I like the fact that you guys talked about just that young knee-jerk reaction to, I guess, different stimuli. Because especially for me, I was very interested and still am about how the mind reacts to certain things almost without us trying. Mm-hmm. Like I wanted you to explain the uncanny valley and like why things that are different as far as slightly or things that are a little off, like why are they creepy? Like humanoids, like why are humanoids so creepy?
Yeah. Yeah. That's a good, the uncanny valley is a good example of a kind of knee-jerk reaction or a type of stimulus that people respond very predictably to. And so the uncanny valley, it's actually an old idea. It's a Japanese roboticist who came up with it in the early 1970s, which is what, like 50 years ago. And he, because he was interested in what happens when robots become more and more human-like. And so he thought the more human-like a robot becomes, the better we're going to like it. But only until a certain point when the robot becomes too human-like for comfort, then the emotional response of people is going to drop. So again, it's an XY as a coordinate system type of situation where he plotted this emotional response versus human-likeness in a graph and then found that the response drops and describes kind of a valley. That's the uncanny valley when the creature becomes too human. And then when it's indistinguishable from a human, our response is positive. And so that effect has been found in many different domains in human-computer interaction. But also in CGI, it's something people take very seriously in Hollywood.
Because yes.
Yeah, if you want to do a computer-generated human-like person, either it has to be very like a caricature, like in a Disney or a Pixar movie. They have huge eyes and big, cute heads and so on. Or it has to be fully realistic. Anything in between those extremes, people are going to, you know, feel creeped out. So why are people creeped out? Probably... It has to do with evolution and human nature. Presumably, it's a defense mechanism that evolved to protect us from infection so that when we come across another human who is very like far from the species norm, somebody who looks very strange, we tend to keep our distance, which is sometimes it's a really shitty thing to do. Like somebody who has had a limb amputated or for whatever reason has a disfigurement, why would you want to go in a circle around them? That's immoral. But that's just human nature, to keep your distance to another member of your own species who is very far from the norm. And that's actually something we find in other species as well, like monkeys. Many monkeys do the same thing, presumably because if a member of their own species has some kind of parasite infection, they will start to look asymmetrical. And then it's a good thing, evolutionarily speaking, to keep your distance. So that's probably what is at the foundation of the uncanny valley phenomenon.
Oh, wow. Yeah. I never thought about it that way, because I just knew as far as what you were saying about how Hollywood takes it so seriously. Mm. I know of a couple examples. You can easily spot it in things like the Beowulf when they tried to make that. And I know my mom, it's so funny because every Christmas we all watch the Polar Express and my mom can't stand it. She's just like, no, I'm not watching. I just can't do it.
They're way too, they're like, it's just, you have no soul, man.
Yeah, no, that's the best example. Yeah, that backfired.
Yeah. No, that backfired really.
It's just, you know, how now we're starting to get into artificial intelligence and we're starting to get that aspect. And people are like, hey, watch out. We don't want to get human-like because, you know, because they're going to replace humans and they have all this fear of just they're going to not be able to tell the difference between like a robot and like a person. And it's like that creepiness of they're so similar to us that it's like, it's creepy. It's just like really weird. It scares us. It's kind of how we do like aliens. Like we can make them like these green things with like eyes. So we like make sure they're like that. They're not as human as they could be. So they could be humanized just like us. And that kind of creeps us out like in the back of our head. That's why you'll never really see too many alien like flicks where they like look like us. And if they do, it's like really creepy.
But more so on like the topic of artificial intelligence, one thing that creeps me out specifically is the situation with Siri and Amazon Alexa. When because basically I like experimented with Siri and Alexa, I said Siri to, and then I said Alexa to Siri, and Siri actually got she was actually confused And somewhat, she just felt like I was an insult. She felt insulted that I said Alexa after I said Siri. And it was strange because it made it seem like Siri had feelings, and it was just weird.
Yeah,
for lack of a better term.
Yeah. I think weird is a good term here because that was too human-like. You don't want your artificial intelligence to seem to express emotions. If you imagine the GPS in your car getting really annoyed because you missed the turn.
Right.
Like it was screaming at you. What the hell is wrong with you, man? Why did you get your driving license? Just that it's. I think it's a good example of the uncanny valley, like something becoming too human-like for comfort. We don't want our artificial intelligences to express strong emotion like jealousy or fear or rage. They should be calm and rational and computer-like and efficient.
Right, because I think the ceiling for that, I don't know if it's not really particularly a horror movie, but I still put it in that genre, Artificial Intelligence by Steven Spielberg. Like that, I love that movie, but I never wanted to get to that point.
The crazy part is, like, because we had somebody on the podcast that was talking about AI and like how advanced it's getting, and it's not anywhere near robots or artificial intelligence having feelings or being able to understand pain, but they're working towards that. That's where their end goal is. So we have that curiosity to want things to be that way, but at the same time, we're like, that's too uncomfortable for me. But it's that curiosity that we want that still. So it's
like just like you just made me think about something, Demetrius, on the topic of people strongly dislike VR gaming, like the VR chats and stuff, because you're able to make this computer generated character and their mouth moves with yours, and with like when you speak they speak, and you can actually replace your image on a video with theirs. And people hate that because, like you said, it's uncanny valley.
Yeah. I think it's a real challenge for many industries, how to get around or how to build a bridge over the uncanny valley, because it's so deep in us to feel creeped out at these humanoids.
No, definitely. So hopefully a lot of that will stay in fantasy and science fiction for now. I know I'm not ready for it.
No,
I don't think I am either.
I'm not ready for that kind of feeling. And I think maybe that's just like, we won't ever get to that point where we are just like, let's have a robot that feels all these emotions, pain, and this, that, the other. And maybe just because we have this uncanny, like that creepiness thing, we'll never get to that point. That's just like evolution saying, we're not doing any of that. This is where you're stopping.
Exactly.
But
go ahead, Josh.
Matthias, on the topic of developing better strategies to stomach watching horror, what I like to do is mute the TV. Speaking on muting the TV, did you conduct any research relating to how music plays a part in horror?
It's something I go into in the book, and it's something I'm really interested in because I think your coping strategy is the best there is. Just turn down the sound, because sound is processed more quickly in the brain than visual stimuli are. And also you can close your eyes and so obstruct a visual signal, but you can't close your ears. And even if you could do this, certain sounds, like very low frequency sounds, will still reach your brain through the body. Those kinds of sounds essentially make the body vibrate. So a sound is a faster and more kind of direct assault that can produce some very powerful emotions. And that's why the jump scare is always a combination of something creepy looking or nasty looking and a sudden loud noise. And it's really the noise that gets you. You don't remember the noise. What you remember is the creepy visual, because that gets stored in your memory. But the startle, the jumping in the seat, that's the sound. And it's really difficult to imagine a horror movie without sound. That used to be the case. Like 100 years ago, horror movies were silent movies. But nowadays, sound is just so important for building an atmosphere of dread, for cueing the right emotions in the viewer, and also for jump scaring the viewer. So if people can't really stomach horror movies, but still want to give them a try, they should not go to the movie theater, because you can't manipulate the sound in the movie theater. They should watch them at home and then turn the sound down.
Exactly.
Yeah.
How do you feel about, speaking of jump scares, so how do you feel about that as a device for getting something across in a scary movie? Because a lot of and I'm sure you feel the same way, a lot of what makes these movies great or these stories great is just the writing. I think to be able to tell a similar story over and over again, but still leave us feeling surprised at the end is really an achievement. Yeah. So do you appreciate the jump scare, or do you think in some movies it's like lazy a little bit?
Yeah, that's a really good question. Because my feelings about the jump scare are complicated. I know that jump scares have like a bad reputation. They're often seen as a lazy technique for producing a very strong, but also not very interesting response in the audience. And certainly there are more, nowadays there are about 10 jump scares per horror movie on average.
Wow.
So in the 60s, it was like 2.5. So there has been an increase in the number of jump scares per movie. But I think certain jump scares are lazy, but in some horror movies, jump scares can become real works of art. Like in Carrie, for example, in the very based on King's novel, in which this teenage girl gets telepathic powers and she has been bullied and she gets back at everybody and kills everybody. And then in the end, she dies. And then her kind of friend visits her grave and is going to put flowers on the grave. And then there's a jump scare where Carrie's hand, you know, comes out of the grave soil and grabs her around the wrist. And I thought that's an example of a good jump scare, because it's not just about startling the audience. It says something about the character and the guilt she feels about the role she played in Carrie's death and so on. So certain jump scares, it can be really unpleasant, like getting a mild electrical shock, a really powerful jump scare. It just galvanizes the body. It's a very primitive stimulus that we share with a lot of other organisms. Like you can jump scare a rat if you wanted to, or a dog. It's really easy. Just sneak up behind it and you boo. And it's the same with humans. And it can be a cheap trick in the hands of a not very competent filmmaker, but it can also be a vehicle for a really interesting effect that requires a lot of intuition about timing, a good jump scare, exquisite timing.
I think that when you talk about like a lazy jump scare, the predictable ones, like you can like see it coming. You're like, oh, they're going to do this jump scare here. I'm just already prepared for it, so it doesn't get you. So that might be the like laziness of a jump scare, but if it's done well, then great.
Yeah. And I think there's always like a kind of arms race between horror filmmakers and horror viewers, because horror viewers like us, we get better at predicting them. So certain films like the Annabelle films, it's very predictable. It's okay. I can see from the patterns of editing and the music and everything that in T minus 17 seconds, there will be a jump scare.
Yeah.
But then horror movie directors know that we know, and so they try to cheat us. Like in It, the new version, the first chapter, there is a scene in which one of the characters, it's the girl, she's being chased by her dad, who is like insane and wants to harm her. And then she runs into the bathroom and the dad comes in and she manages to knock him out. And we feel, phew, she got rid of the danger. But then the camera kind of pans and there is Pennywise standing in the door. Like, boom, with a huge jump scare. And you did not see that coming. I thought that was a good example of a very well-timed jump scare.
No, it is. A lot of movies now that differentiate from like the powerhouses. Because when a lot of people, or some people that I talk to, when they say what their favorite horror movie is, because I talk about it a lot, and they're always like, yeah, I love the Insidious movies or the Annabelle movies. And I'm just like, really? I'm like, they follow the same thing every single time. But I noticed, I agree with you, like with the It movie, that scene in particular, and I love the projector scene. I love the projector scene. Right, spoiler warning. And I love like Hereditary. Like I think the jump scare in that was because I knew something was gonna happen. And then when like his younger sister's head gets just like decapitated and it just hits the ground like a pumpkin. It is just, oh my God. Like it was just that's a great jump scare, but I love the way that it builds. And like you said, it's not a jump scare that is just put there for the sake of scaring the audience. It drives the story forward, because that's exactly what starts the whole thing.
That's a good example.
Or like a horror movie that I love in particular is Midsommar.
I
would say Midsommar does like multiple jump scares in succession because the camera is so uncomfortably close.
Mm-hmm.
all the time, right?
Yeah. That movie made me not want to go to Sweden again.
Exactly. It's oh man, traveling is scary.
Yes, that's one of the take-home messages from horror movies.
Yes, definitely. Yeah. Don't travel. Definitely. Don't go into the woods like at all. Yep. Just never go to a cabin because like
yes.
It, that was something that, like, because I went to a cabin, right, like, a little bit before the pandemic happened, I went on a cabin trip, and we went out in the middle of, like, nowhere, and the whole entire time, I'm sitting there with my, like, horror brain, something might happen there, it might be a home invasion, there might be some kind of creepy, like, creature out there or something, and I'm just looking, staring over, I'm like, something's gonna happen, so the whole time I was paranoid, I'm like, oh, no.
Yeah,
not good. I shouldn't watch that many horror movies.
But like Matthews was talking about, you've seen Cabin in the Woods, you've seen Cabin Fever, so you've already have gone through this in your head. So many
exactly, times. You've been through all the different scenarios in your head. If you find a weird book with the face on the cover, don't open it.
Talking about Evil Dead, like you find a book in the basement, or you find that weird stuff in the basement, don't open it, don't read it, you know?
No.
Exactly. But where are you at, Matthews? What have you been taking in lately as far as horror is concerned? Do you have any, like, any references, like, for our audience or anything, like, movies and books?
Huh. I've been reading a lot of horror novels by an American writer called Robert McCammon, who was huge in the 80s, but then people forgot about him. But he has done some really good stuff, post-apocalyptic stuff and straight-up horror stuff.
So
I'd recommend Robert McCammon. And then movie-wise, I don't know, I really enjoyed, like, some of the recent shows, like Haunting of Hill House.
Was that good? I haven't had a chance to see it yet. Okay.
And that's full of good jump scares. It has one that really almost killed me. And I'm Yeah, and I'm jaded by now.
Well, if it got you, I gotta watch that.
Yeah.
And something else, actually something I tried just last week on a recommendation from a student is a video game. It's called Phasmophobia. And you play like a group together. This will be perfect for you guys. We were four and you're a ghost hunter. And so you go into a house and you have to see where the ghost is and find out what kind of ghost, and you can place cameras and look for weird like traces of the ghost. So it's detective mystery, but also super scary once the ghost comes out and haunts you. So that's going to be a recommendation also.
Okay, awesome. We're going to definitely check that out. And yeah, guys, for all our viewers and listeners, we'll put all of that in the description below. And yeah, Matthews, I don't know if you've seen it, but like I'm huge on psychological horror. That's just, that's my thing. And recently the film and the book, because I read it and watched it, it just really got to me. And I talked about it with my friends, with these guys, for it had me for at least 2 months. I rarely watch a film twice. It's the book is by Ian Reid. It's called I'm Thinking of Ending Things. Have you heard of that?
Oh, yeah. My daughter was telling me about it. I haven't seen or read it yet, but it goes straight to my list.
It is so good. Like, I agree with your daughter. Please watch it. I'm Thinking of Ending Things. The movie's really good, too. Both are they are a little different in the way that they play out, but definitely read the book, watch the movie, and definitely for all of our viewers and listeners out there, do the same. I'm Thinking of Ending Things is such a great horror story. And by the way, what's your favorite? Oh, yeah, you're welcome. And what's your favorite, like, subgenre of horror? What do you like?
That's really difficult. I don't think I can say all of it. I'm not big on torture porn or same. You know, the very kind of, like pretty much everything else.
Yeah,
like
same.
Torture porn is like soft.
Yeah, that sort of thing. Yeah, that was big for about 10 years. But I dig the supernatural stuff, the occult stuff, the psychological stuff, the monster stuff, the zombie stuff. If it's frightening, I want it.
Same here, definitely. Do you guys, Josh and Demetrius, do you have any like anything to reference for our viewers and listeners horror-wise?
I would say check out the TV series Hannibal. I'm still pretty emotionally scarred from that show.
It's horrible. Have you seen that, Matthews? Have you watched Hannibal?
I still gotta watch that.
Oh my goodness. That's on my list. Yeah. It is so, and I've watched all the movies, like, the TV show, like, Hannibal is crazy. I didn't think and that was on regular network television. Like, some of those, and it's the only reason I won't say is torture porn is because they show really grotesque murders, but it's 80% psychological, like 80. So I would totally recommend. That's a good one, Joshua.
Yeah.
So I would recommend that as well.
Yeah.
I'll put it this way, like me and Joshua sat and watched that whole series in about a week. So that's how good it is. Yeah, that's how good it is. While I was doing my homework. So
Right. That's psychological horror for you.
Those are always the best. That's like the best genre to do because it's like, it's not grotesque. It's, oh man, this is some stuff that I could see in the real world, and it doesn't have to be like, oh man, he's just going around killing everybody.
So but it could be the nice guy down the street. Like I said, because Hannibal, he's not a mean person. He's just like a really nice guy. He waters his plants, and then he's got a guy in the basement downstairs. So
it's like that double life kind of thing. Like he's like nice here, but like downstairs, he's able to be that other self. Like
he's still nice. He's just killing the person. And he's very, very mannerable about it. And he's just, hey, would you like a piece of your leg that I just fried? It's delicious. What about you, Dimitri?
Right now, I can't think of anything to recommend. But if I do, I will literally put it in the description down below, so it'll be there. But right now, I'm blanking. But okay, I'm gonna watch Hannibal, though. I gotta get into that.
Everybody watch Hannibal. I'm telling you, it's amazing. But yes, Matthews, it's been such a pleasure talking to you today.
If it has.
Same here. Thanks so much for having me on the show.
Thanks for being here.
Oh, yeah. No, thanks for being here. It's been awesome. Yeah. I'm always, like, we have to have you back. I'm always down to talk horror, like, 100%.
I'm on.
But before we let you go, I wanted you to let all our viewers and listeners know about what you got going on. Talk about your books. Specifically, I know you mentioned A Nervous Person's Guide to Horror Movies, and you also have Why Horror Seduces. You know, talk about a lot of that and where they can find you on social media, all that good
stuff. Mm-hmm. Yep. So Why Horror Seduces came out in 2017. And it's an academic book. I tried not to make it too dry. It goes into the psychology of horror, and I talk about different famous American horror novels and horror movies, and also the potential of horror video games and haunted attractions to create more immersive experiences. And the new book, Nervous Person's Guide to Horror Movies, comes out, I think, around Halloween this year. And that's a book I'm really excited about because I tried to write it in such a way that anybody could read it and get something out of it. And also we're doing some interesting studies on the psychology of horror. And I have a lab, like a research lab. It's called the Recreational Fear Lab. And the viewers and listeners can visit the lab at www.fear.au.dk. And they can learn more about the research. I also have a Twitter profile. That's just an @ and then my name. And I also tweet about some of my research on that channel. So that's where folks can find me.
Cool. Awesome stuff. And once again, guys, we'll put all of that in the description below. And yeah, folks. Guys, just like every week. Oh, what's up, Josh?
Oh, yeah. One more thing. Yeah, Matthias, what was up with that zombie in your TED Talk? Like,
oh, yeah.
I really wanted to do something out of the ordinary. So I recruited a zombie from our collaborators at the Haunted House, and I think it gave it a little bit of extra spice.
No, the spice was definitely there.
actually, I wanted a horde of zombies, like 20 or 30 zombies that would slowly emerge from like smoke in the back. But the TEDx people didn't. They didn't want to go along with that. But I did get my one zombie.
Man.
They could at least give you like 5 zombies.
Right.
Yeah, that was my argument too.
But no, regardless, the effect was still there. It was still pretty cool. That's always great to have a visual. So that's always good stuff. But yeah, guys, like every week, guess what time it is?
Shameless promotional.
Yes. So it is time for our Shameless Promotional. And guys, we are the Square Roundtable Podcast. And you can catch us every Friday on MajorZoneMusic.com at 10 a.m. Pacific Time, 12 p.m. Central Time, and 1 p.m. Eastern Time.
And you can catch us on Friday on YouTube at any time that you want at the Square Roundtable Podcast. If you liked the video, smack that like button. Also, share our video if you like it. Hit the notification bell underneath the video so you're notified of our future videos and this one. And comment down below your favorite horror movie genre. If you checked out his books or, you know, anything in between. Or your thoughts on AI. We talked about a lot of things today. And and follow us on our socials, Instagram and Twitter at the Square Roundtable, Square Roundtable 1, and at on Twitter at Square Roundtable, and join our Facebook group. We definitely want some people to engage with us there.
Yes, join us in our zombie of a Facebook group, our dying Facebook chat. That's the real horror, how dead our Facebook group is. So please.
If you want to see a great horror depiction, just join there, man.
Definitely, guys. Definitely. But yeah, guys, reach out and talk to us, man. We love to talk definitely about whatever horror film you guys like. Let us know your favorite horror movie. We'll definitely chat it up with you guys. But yes, y'all, before we head out, I would love everybody, including our awesome guests, to introduce themselves again before we head out. And I am your host, Chad Singleton.
Dimitri.
Josh Singleton.
And I'm Matthias Clayson.
And this has been the Square Roundtable. We are out, guys. Peace.